There are four data sets which we have chosen. I would be taking one data set and would be solving the problem statement using Mahout. This time there is no R. I would tell you the problem statement, and since the same problem statement is, I mean the solution for that problem statement, the algorithm for it is already inbuilt in Mahout. It's available just like a command, so we can just run it and get the output. I will take you through step by step. The idea is to get a feel of what does it take to solve a particular problem via Mahout. What might be the steps which are required? We are not going to discuss any algorithm right now. We are not going to discuss what exactly are the different parameters which we, definitely we will be discussing about what exactly are the parameters which we are going to calculate, how we arrived to those particular parameters and all. We will go in depth, you know, when from next class onwards we would be discussing about algorithms, and before that I think briefly about R, and then you know some algorithm implementation with R and other stuff. At that time Atul would be discussing these things in great detail with each and every of you. Okay, is that clear, guys? Okay, now just check, seems like some coming. Great. Now when it comes to a data set, so it's again the data scientist role and all, so you always have typically a problem data set and you have to give some sort of analysis result using some of the tools, right? Here's the data set too which we are focusing today. It's about retail sector. So the domain of the data set is the retail, and the algorithm which we are going to apply is a frequent pattern growth. If you are already aware of frequent pattern growth, good. If you are not aware, we will just give you a background of it. You will understand it when we will tell you what exactly are the kind of the metrics which we are trying to calculate out of it. More on that, how exactly we arrived at and all, will be the matter of next class. The problem statement which we are trying to solve, we are solving it for retail, but it is not limited to retail only. So it will be applicable for all the domains wherever you have a co-occurrence kind of a scenario. So more than one item, or how many items, or I would say how many objects basically are occurring together. If you have to find out the possibility of it and the chances of it, right? So some of those metrics, how to calculate those are the part here. In case of retail, we are just calculating. It is, you can apply it anywhere. Now the problem statement which we have is, we have an Excel sheet, okay, which is having a list of transactions by multiple buyers in a particular retail store, and this retail outlet wants to understand basically the purchasing behavior of a specific buyer. Okay, so purchasing behavior of a specific buyer is like somebody, so the example which is given here itself is about, so analysis might tell a retailer that customers often purchase shampoo and conditioner together, right? So if you are putting both of them, right, in any promotion scheme, if you are going to put both of them together, it might not increase profit to you. It might not increase the profit. Whereas if you do the promotion which just involves only one of the items, automatically the sale of the other might increase, right? Just one of the thing. Or again, you know the other angle of it. Since I am from retail angle, I mean I am from retail domain, I can give you more examples of it. So the same, I would continue with the same thing. Let's say people often buy chips along with beer, right? So you know if there is a growth in a specific kind of let's say a specific kind of commodity, what exactly would be the other kind of commodities which you know which would automatically increase in demand, so that you can plan your inventory accordingly. So some of the things which might be known, some of the things which might not be known, which there might be some indirect relation. So these kind of relations get exposed by the you know the algorithm which is called frequent pattern growth algorithm. Okay, is the problem statement clear to everybody? Guys, is it clear? Can I now move to the details part of it? Great. So for this, I have noted down the steps itself first in a notepad, and then I will show you directly in the machine. Okay. So the first thing first is, what we are going to do is, we are going to have, see, this is the file which we, this is a data source, actual data source, which has been downloaded. I will tell you the source a bit later. So this is a you know publicly available data source, wherein this guy is having, you know, these are different basket IDs. Each basket ID like C11867 or C5096 or C4295, etc. They are like each and every customer transaction. Okay. Now, on the horizontal side, you can see this hair conditioner, lemons, standard coffee, frozen chicken wings, okay, 98% fat-free hamburger, sugar cookies, etc. All of these are the items, right? All of these are items. And now you can see for this particular, let's say a specific basket, if it is false, means that particular person has not purchased it, right? Only if you find it true, let's say I will go here, okay, this example C1895, row number 9, this guy, if I go here, basically this guy has bought 98% fat free hamburger. This is true for this guy. And then if I continue on the same lines, right, then the very same guy has bought something called potato chips, etc. So is the data layout clear? Guys, is the data layout clear? The input data for us, right? It's a Excel sheet. It's an Excel sheet or comma separated value sheet, CSV sheet, wherein we are having multiple items and multiple transactions. True means somebody has bought that item. False means somebody has not bought that item, right? Now, so the first thing first, for our algorithm to work, we need the data in a bit more friendlier format. Means what I can do here is, I can take this particular basket, right? Either I can process the data in the same way, which is data, or I can do some conditioning of this data. I can say particular item, let's say I will go to C1895, this guy has bought 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17. So C1895, 5, 17, something, wherever it is true, I will just put those numbers or those indexes. So if I can just do that, my data size is reduced, right? And at the same time, I would be having much more clarity. Okay, which person has bought what? I'm not interested in which person has not bought what, right? I'm interested in what are the items which each and every person has bought. So let us first have a very small program. So guys, the first command which you are seeing here, which I would be running on my machine, I am actually calling a specific program, convert CSV to DAT. See this, convert CSV to DAT. It's a simple Java program which I have called. Okay, what I am trying to do is I am calling this guy and I am passing this CSV file path to this program, and when I will run this program, it will create two files. See, I am first giving you the flow so that when I execute, right, you should be very, very clear that okay, Vishal is doing step one, Vishal is doing step two, so and so forth. So when I run this program, it will create two output files. One is output.dat, which will contain the transaction data. I just told, right, new format. I need it. This particular person has bought item 5, 3, 28, 29, etc. So that those, that list would be there in output.dat. Second file will have, there would be another file which would be created, that would be mapping.csv. Now, what is the mapping.csv? So basically mapping.csv is like air conditioner, lemons, standard, coffee, etc., etc. So if I assign hair conditioner as number 1, lemons as number 2, standard coffee number 3, frozen chicken wings number 4, so and so forth, all of them are item IDs. And you know, if I say item ID 4, then it means frozen chicken wings, right? So that is the mapping which we are creating here by ourselves. Is that part clear? Guys, is that part clear to everybody? Because now I will go and run the first part. Then I will come back to this slide, we'll run the second part and so forth. Okay, now I'm going to the machine. Okay, now this is, what is this machine? So it's a Cloudera virtual machine, okay, and which is available, I mean the standard installations are available. You will be see, you will be able to see when we'll be talking about Mahout installation, you know, Mahout installations and all. For now, you can install this machine, okay. It's a VM here, yeah. Okay, I'm already, before the class I made sure that yes, sorry, yes, that everything is working perfectly. So I am going to run, guys, my first command, which is, just a sec, okay, rather than typing and wasting time, I just want, yep. So it's a project which I have already set up here. Let me just show you. PWD. I'm at /home/cloudera. This is my project path. Mahout frequent pattern mining example. Okay. If I do ls, it's a Maven project, right? And it is having multiple files, right? Source, target. Basically, target would be the one wherein my executables are there. Okay, so that's why when I give this command, right, so what I'm trying to do is I'm executing a Java file which is available at target/mahout frequent pattern mining example.jar, right? I have created this jar using Maven Mahout, using, you know, Maven package command. Okay, guys, you are aware of Maven tool and all, right? Because I'm assuming this is a basic thing. So you create a Java project and oops. Okay, so if you are not aware, then you need to know Java essentials and all, Nitya. Some of the ramping up has to happen. Okay, and so just to tell, it's like a build tool. Okay, so you write your Java programs and all, and then you convert them in the form of jar. So either you can simply do a jar, or there is a tool called ant, and then there is a tool called Maven. So most of the latest projects are into Maven. In fact, Hadoop itself has moved to Maven now. Okay, earlier it was an AND. So I mean that was a build tool and all. So please, it's a don't worry. In Mahout Essentials, right? You will find all of these commands. How to set up a project. Okay, Nitya and everybody who is not aware of Maven. Now, so using Maven, actually I created this project. So that's why I'm saying I'm assuming that it is clear. So what I'm trying to do is this is my jar. Within jar, I'm calling my program convert CSV to DAT. Okay, and I'm passing this market basket.csv, the same CSV which you saw, right? The same CSV, this one, right? I'm just passing this guy, this input, and I'm running this program. So fast. It created the output, wrote 1361 transactions also. Okay. Now, if you say ls, you will see this output.dat mapping.csv. Right? Now let's have a look. Output.dat head. Okay. So what is it having? See this 159, 131, 231, 76, 122. What does it mean? What does it mean? So I'll show you one by one here. See this. See this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Let me go here. Let me go here. 8. Okay. So let me go to the 8th transaction here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay. This is 8th transaction. Now, see this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 at fifth place it is true and the same thing is shown in this eighth transaction 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 eighth transaction he bought item ID 5 next he bought so this was 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17. So next should be 17. See this. 17. Similarly, 37, 43, 48, so and so forth. If I say head minus, let's say 10, you will see more. Is this part clear? Guys, is this part clear to everybody? May I get the response, guys? Then quickly I can move to the next step, show you one by one. Great. Great. Now, so this was output.dat. Let us see what is there in mapping.csv, right? So I'll say cat mapping.csv and I'll just say head. So see this, basket ID 0, hair conditioner 1, lemon 2, this exactly is the thing which I was talking about, right? Basket ID 0, hair conditioner 1, lemon 2, standard coffee 3, so and so forth. So we've just created a mapping. Are the contents clear to everybody? Not only to Nitya, to others also. Guys? Right? Great. Now, so this is the second part which we achieved. So this is where we are still not into the algorithm. We have just created, I mean, we have conditioned our input data in such a way so that we can analyze it. Now, we are going to analyze this data using Hadoop. So whatever output got created is still in the Linux system. Okay, I have to move this data into HDFS. Okay, so Hadoop fs-ls, this is the command which tells me what all is there. So before coming to the class, I ran this example Hadoop fs-ls mouth input. Basically, you can see this. I have moved this output dot det already. Okay, I have moved this output dot det already into this place. But for the demo purpose, I am removing it. Hadoop fs hyphen rmr. Sorry, this slash output dot det. I have removed it. And now I will copy the freshly created output dot dat to basically mouth underscore ip path. Okay, so what I am going to do is Hadoop fs hyphen copy from local, or I can just say put. Okay, then this is output dot dat to slash user slash cloudera slash mouth underscore ip. Okay, this is where, see this, this exactly is the command which I'm running here in notepad. See this, Hadoop fs hyphen put output dot dat, this is a different path, I'm copying it here in mouth underscore input, and I have done this. Okay, so now if I say Hadoop fs minus ls, the file is already available. See this. Is this part clear, guys? Is this part clear? Can I quickly move? I mean, this is nothing but I am just putting the data into Hadoop now. Now is the command which will run our frequent pattern growth algorithm. Okay. Now, what I will do is I will execute this command. Mouth FPG. So before I tell you what is mouth FPG and all, how did I come here? I'll come here. I will say mouth FPG. Okay, this is the command which I'm going to run, but before I run this command, I have to do something here. I have to say Hadoop fs hyphen rmr patterns, and that's it. What I did is I just deleted patterns output directory. In Hadoop, if you have already run the output, so it would have failed. Otherwise, my program would have failed saying that output path already exists. So I have deleted my output path. Now I am going to run this particular command, mouth FPG. So just a sec. If you want to know how many programs are available to you, how many algorithms are already available to you, you just need to type mouth. If mouth is installed, if you just type mouth, press enter. It would create a big list of algorithms. So these algorithms are already inbuilt and available. Split, sequence dumper, row ID, right? Similarly, if you just go a bit up, see this, FPG, frequent pattern growth. This is the algorithm which I'm going to run now. Okay, now what I'm going to do is, I'm going to run that. Mouth FPG. Okay, mouth FPG. I'll explain these things. Hyphen I means input. Input is that output dot dat, right, which we created. Output is the patterns. So this would be the HDFS directory where output would be created. Now K is equal to 10. And method is MapReduce. I will tell what is K, what is S. So method is equal to MapReduce means we are saying run this algorithm using MapReduce. Now using K and 10. So here K 10 means for each item I, right? Whatever item were there, lemon, etc., etc., find out the top 10 association rules. Okay, for top basically you want the top 10 association rules, and the rules are that the set of items including the item I, right, which occurs in the biggest number of transactions, means maximum associations with item I which appear in the maximum number of transactions together. And then S equal to 2 means you will consider only the items which appear in at least more than 2 transactions. So S is like your threshold, right? Okay, now I'm going to run this. It would take some time. Sorry. See this. This is the MapReduce job which it has fired. So your FPG is running on MapReduce, by the way. Some of this part might not be making much of the sense for you. What is map? What is reduce? What is mouth FPG command? Don't worry. We'll come back, because the idea is not to show you what is FPG. Idea is to show you what it takes to run a specific algorithm via MAU. Guys, at least the flow is making sense to you guys. Bala, Nitya, and Lakshman. Guys. Okay, great. Now that it has run its output, let's see what is next. So guys, this will generate, you know, various directories in the output. Basically, there would be the directory like flist, frequent patterns, fp growth, parallel counting, etc., etc., etc. Now, right now we'll focus only on two directories. One is frequent patterns, one is flist. Now, flist is the sequence file which associates, okay, to an item versus the number of transactions which are containing that particular item. Okay, I'll tell you a bit more detail about this. And the frequent pattern is the sequence file which which basically contains that how many times a particular item has occurred in different transactions. Okay, so what does it mean? It means, I'll show you by showing you frequent patterns. When you will see the frequent patterns, okay, I think I have to show you directly here, then I'll show you in machine. So this is the command which I'm going to fire next: mouth sequence dumper hyphen I patterns, and then I'm going to see frequent patterns. So basically this is a command to see the contents of frequent patterns file which has been generated, and the output would be something like this: key 0, value 0, 80, 141, 0, 42, 132, 0, 42, 124, 0, 39, etc., etc., etc. Okay, what do we understand out of it? Now, I will tell you here, that's what we have written here very, very clearly. See this, the first line itself tells that these are the top 10 associations of item number 0. So see this, 0 alone occurs 80 times in transactions, means 80 times people have bought only and only 0, item 0. Now item 0 along with 141, see this, item 0 along with 141 has occurred 42 times. Okay, so item 0 and item 141 have been purchased together 42 times. Similarly, 0 and 132 have been purchased 42 times. 0 and 124, that combination has been purchased 39 times, right? Now combination of 0, 141 and 132 has been purchased 30 times, and so and so forth. Is that part clear? The second one, 1 along with 41, one single, you know, only one has been purchased 41 times. Then one with 141 has been purchased 25 times. One with 132 has been purchased 25 times, and so and so forth. So 10 such associations, because you remember you gave 10 here as the input, 10 associations. Is this part clear to everybody? How the output is gonna look like? Because I am now going to fire the command to show you the output. So my idea was to show you first what does it, I mean, whatever output you are seeing, how to make a sense out of it. Right? Now I am going to fire this command. So I am going to say mouth sequence dumper. Sorry guys, we are 15 minutes over, but I hope you guys are liking it, because we are just, you know, discussing all these parts. So this is just one thing. Just I have dumped it, right? So like you can see this, item number 92, 14 times, item number 92 with 142, 10 times, item number 92 with 125, 10 times, and so forth, right? So that was about the output. Now, what next? Next part which we are going to do is here. We are going to calculate basically these four matrices here. Okay, these are the four matrices which we are calculating. One is called support for a particular item, and the formula which we have chosen here is support for a particular item means number of transactions which contain a particular item divided by total number of transactions. Okay, so let's say I want to calculate the support for 0. So I have to see number of transactions which contain only 0, not 0, not only, which contain 0 divided by total number of transactions. Is this part clear to everybody? Is this part clear? What is support? Right? Guys, could you please reply? Right? Similarly, confidence of X and Y means it is the proportion of the transactions which contain Y also. If you have purchased X, so you are saying, the kind of confidence that yes, people will purchase Y also if they purchase X. So the formula for that is you have to calculate the support for X union Y divided by, you have to calculate the support for X itself. So these are the various formula. Some of you may come back and say, how have you, even though the formulae are simple, but still some of you may come back and say, how have you come up to this formula? So answer would be, either somebody would have given you this formula or you would have achieved this formula. So in the coming classes, we will be showing you how we are coming up to these formulae and all. For now, these are the formulae which we are trying to calculate. Is this part clear, guys? So I'm actually quickly rushing through. See, these are the four things which we are going to calculate for each and every item. Support for X, support for X and Y, and then the lift and conviction. These are the four things which we are going to do now. Is this part clear? Now, what we are going to do is, with the next command, what we are trying to do here is, we are taking frequent patterns. See, the output is created in HDFS. Now, I have to take it back from HDFS. When I get this output, okay, this frequent patterns and FList, I will take these two files back from HDFS to the Linux system, and then finally I will pass them through my final program, that is result reader. So mouth has prepared the result, but I have to show that result. I mean, if I show you the key values, will you understand anything? Okay. Guys, am I audible to everybody? Guys, am I audible to everybody? Right? Okay, great, great. So, yep, I was coming to the point wherein what we are trying to do is we are taking these files out of HDFS and then we are going to run them through this Java program, which will produce these key value pairs in some sort of readable output. That's all we are trying to do. Okay, now I will not run these two commands because I have already taken these outputs here. So I will show you in the machine and I'll run the last command for you. Just a sec, let me clear it out. Then let me say ls. See, what I did is this flist.sequence, okay, flist.sequence and frequentPatterns.sequence. Basically, I have taken them already before the class out itself. I just to save the time since we are already 20 minutes overdue, right? So I'm not running these two commands. I will directly run my last part. Okay, Java that basically result reader, and then I'll explain one by one what exactly are the different parameters. Okay. I think before running that itself, let me explain. See this. Yeah. So what is it? Basically, I'm calling a result reader. It's a Java class. Okay. We'll talk about code and what exactly is the code and all. That is something which we'll talk about in that next session itself. But here, what I'm trying to do is I'm passing several parameters. So what am I passing? I'm passing total number of transactions. You remember that 1361 transactions process, so it's the same number. Now I am passing mapping.csv, right? That mapping, this item represents this item ID represents a specific item and all. That one, frequent list.sequence and frequent patterns.sequence. Okay, so these things should be clear. Now these are two different numbers, 0.04 and 0.4. What are these? Now they tell the minimum support and minimum confidence. So I want to know all the transactions, right, where in the minimum support for a particular item is at least 0.04, means 4% chance that I will definitely buy a particular item, and the minimum confidence, okay, that I will buy along with an item some other item also, if I'll buy at least some, that 0.4 confidence or 40% confidence that yes, I will buy item Y also if I buy item X. So I'm interested for all the items where at least I'm 4% sure that yes, I am going to buy a particular item, and all the list of related items for which I'm nearly 40% sure, I mean mathematically 40% sure that yes, they will also be bought. Okay, is this part clear? Guys, is this part clear? Because I'm going to run it now, right? Okay, now what I'm going to do is, just a sec, let me run it right away. Yeah. No, not this. Yep. So now I'm going to run it. Since it's there, so this is the kind of output which would be produced. Yeah. So let's say this. Potato chips. 98%, along with it, fat free hamburger, support is 0.043, confidence level is 0.465, lift conviction, which we are not discussing as of now, let's focus only on confidence and support part of it. Eggs and sweet relish, you can see this, it makes sense as well, because somebody who buys eggs, buys sweet relish also, the support for X item is 0.45, and the confidence that somebody buys, why, you know, sorry, where am I? I have just lost it. Yes, that somebody buys eggs will buy sweet relish also is 0.526, and similarly other items, right? So this last part of interpreting the result is like is your own Java program, and converting the input to a desirable input format is again kind of Java program or whatever program you want to write would be your job. Most of these algorithms are already inbuilt. So just like you saw that FPG, right? FPG was just as a command which was already available with mouth. You just ran it and basically it would just produce the required output for you. So you just pass the correct parameters to it. Okay?